Spirit for a New Generation, Chapter 7, we talk about some pastoral considerations. So, Dr. Kerry, you begin this chapter with an interesting verse that seems to combine the manifestation gifts of the Spirit and the Son's gifts, the ministry gifts. Can you explain that to us, and what's the significance of that verse?
It's really interesting to me, and especially if you're a leader in the church, you'll want to take a close look. This is later on in the same chapter, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 27, 28. Paul says, and it sounds like Ephesians 4, he starts out with the Son's gifts, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers. But he starts out with, first of all, apostles. Secondly, he actually gives 1, 2, 3. Secondly, prophets. And then thirdly, teachers. And you would expect, okay, there's 3 of the 5. The next one's going to be a pastor and the evangelist. But instead of saying pastor and evangelist, he shifts back to the manifestation gifts. So he says, then after that are miracles and gifts of healings. Well, who needs miracles and gifts of healing in their tool belt to do their ministry more than the evangelist? So when Paul wants to refer to the gift of the evangelist or the ministry of evangelism, he's saying what you need to draw people to the Father is working of miracles and gifts of healing. Very interesting. Now he hasn't mentioned the pastor yet. You'd expect him to say pastor, but what he says instead is administrations and helps and diversities of tongues. You say, what's that about? Well, that really leads us to the purpose of this chapter. Because you see, if you're going to cultivate a people that are free and bold to move in the gifts of the Spirit, the pastoral leadership has to create an environment of safety and security. That means pastors have to be first and foremost equipped and ready to move in the gifts of the Spirit, especially the utterance gifts, diverse kinds of tongues, interpretation of tongues, and prophecy. You see, if the Spirit is wanting to teach you how to move in the gifts, but your pastor doesn't allow it, or if you have a prompting by the Holy Spirit to speak something out, but the pastor's afraid of that, then guess what? You're not going to feel bold to do that. It's not going to be something that happens in the atmosphere of your community. But when the pastor is equipped in his tool belt, is this free flow of the manifestation gifts of the Spirit as a part of how he does it, all of a sudden, now we have a pastor that's modeling the manifestation of gifts in front of us, and it becomes normal for the congregation to move in the gifts. The other thing is, let's take, for example, diverse kinds of tongues. Let's say the Lord moves on someone in a congregation to begin to speak out a message to the congregation in a diverse kind of tongue. And I've seen this happen many times. Somebody speaks out a message in another language, and then we all wait for someone to give the interpretation, and no one speaks up. Well, if no one gives the interpretation, the pastor is supernaturally equipped. He has the tool in his tool belt to interpret that message. So this is a powerful picture that Paul gives us of how men and women in the fivefold ministry, apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher, are also supernaturally endowed to do that ministry. Why? So that the rest of us can sit back and watch them work? No. So that we see a modeling of supernatural ministry, and then we're encouraged to flow into that and to experiment, to be used of the Lord in all kinds of ways that we've never been used before.
So this really paints a picture that all these manifestations of the Spirit should be happening within the church as well as outside gathering church.
Yes, and especially in Paul's context, dealing with issues that were going on in the Corinthian church, he really showed us that this cocoon or this incubator of the atmosphere of the supernatural power of God, the city of Corinth had all kinds of gods, as you know, and all kinds of temples. But Paul said, this temple, the gathering of God's people, is where the Holy Spirit inhabits and manifests himself. And so this is really important for us, especially in the context of our gatherings. There should be a freedom to move in the gifts of the Spirit, and the leadership should be modeling that to us and then releasing and encouraging us to flow in that. But then once we learn how to do that, then of course, as the Lord sends us out, he is confirming the word that's preached or testified with signs and wonders and miracles.
So what is the key guideline that you would like to give to pastors, leaders, or, you know, people in the church in general about about the use of the manifestation gifts?
Well, the key guideline, of course, is love. We've been saying that again and again. The key guideline is that if you will be filled with the love of God, and this is what happens with spirit fullness. The Holy Spirit lives in you. When you learn how to stay full of the Spirit, singing songs, hymns, spiritual songs, making melody in your heart to the Lord, worshiping Him in the Spirit, using your prayer language, then that process is going to fill you with love for others. You cannot be full of the Spirit and not be falling in love with broken people, because that's what's in the Father's heart. So let's when we're talking about or teaching the gifts of the Spirit, let's make sure this stays the main thing. The main thing is that we're giving the Father a way to connect with people in their brokenness and bring healing and life and wholeness to that brokenness. In the process, we're also teaching our people how to be released in the gifts of the Spirit. The gifts of the Spirit are not just for leaders. They're for the whole church to be doing the work of the ministry through the whole body of Christ. And everybody's seeing, I'm on God's radar. God loves me. God has a great plan for my life. His purposes for me are wonderful, and He's healing my brokenness. This is a church that's alive, a church that is flowing in supernatural giftings motivated by love is a church that's going to be thriving. It's going to be dynamically changing its city and changing its people. So I pray that that would be the core and the key for us in all that we do, is that in large settings and small settings, we figure out how to cultivate. This would be the last thing I would say. If you're pastoring a church, and especially the American model for the last 20, 25 years has been church growth. Let's grow the church as big as we can. One of the negatives of a big, big church is we don't have time. We don't make room for the Holy Spirit to work, to come and to either speak prophetic words or to release gifts of healings. And so we as leaders have to find ways to break the church down into smaller groups where that kind of ministry is released. Nevertheless, if they don't see us as leaders modeling these gifts of the Spirit, they're not going to feel bold to do it themselves. What we model in front of the people by the Holy Spirit equips them to see it as normal and then to take that to their world. We have to break down our groups into small groups where people can feel safe to step out in the gifts of the Spirit. We have to model that in whatever settings we have so people can see it. Not showboat, not look at me, I'm the one with the word of knowledge, look at me, I'm the one that can heal people. No, we have to be articulating to all of our people all the time, you can do this, you can do this. Covet and desire the best gifts. And when you do, you're going to see your church come alive in touching the broken world and seeing what Jesus wants to do in them. So I hope you enjoy this little chapter of Pastoral Reflections.